Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Productivity Mastery Podcast. My name is Stoyan, and I'm super, super excited to have one of the most amazing people that I've been following actually for years. His name is Shane Hurlbut, and he's a prolific, very prolific DOP, director of photography from Hollywood, having shot a number of exceptional productions, iconic pictures such as Need for Speed, Terminator, Salvation, and many, many more movies.
Thank you so much for having me on this show. I'm so looking forward to it. My wife, Lydia, said it was absolutely amazing when she was on. So I was like, hey, let me get a piece of Stoyan. Let's get this thing going.
Let's do it. Let's do it, Shane. How are you this morning?
Where
are you?
I am fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
That is amazing. We have the first pair of hearts being sent to us from Ann Patterson. Ann, thank you for watching. Thank you for being with us. Shane, many people listening right now, they're coming from the world of entrepreneurship, business, and they might be wondering, this guy is a director of photography. What does that even mean? So could you maybe give us a bit of an idea? What do you actually do as a director of photography?
Yeah, so director of photography directs all the photography on the film or the commercial or music video. So that has a lot to do with, you know, taking the emotion of the characters and of the script and being able to assist in that process of how I'm lighting a scene is based on the emotion of the scene, how the camera moves, what it feels like. Is it handheld so it feels uneasy? Is it very stoic and locked off? Is it very fluid? All these are based, everything is based on emotion. So as a director of photography, I take the script as my Bible, and those emotions I'm taking and deconstructing and turning them into what the lighting and mood and tone is going to feel like in every scene, as well as what the camera emotion is going to be as well. And that's deciding which camera we shoot with, which lenses, the soul of the movie we use, what the lighting instruments, is it going to be something that's hard contrast? Is it going to be very colorful? Is it going to be more desaturated? All these tones, figuring out a lookbook and color blocking and design and schematics and blocking schematics and shot listing. This is all part of the director of photography's job. As well as running a team that can be as small as 10 people to, like on Terminator Salvation, I had 295 camera grip and electric technicians all working alongside me on that film. So, you know, it's a big leadership as well, and trying to organize and set the team up for success the best as possible.
I think for people who are not in the movie business, they might get surprised how many people actually behind a production just in the yes. department that you're running. But I want to go back in time and hear more about your beginnings and how did you get excited to start being a director of photography? As I understand, you actually have been trying a lot of different things, including being a musician, DJing, and so on and so forth. So could you share with us the beginnings of the story and what brought you to where you are today?
Yeah, sure. So when I was in high school, I was a jock. Okay. I played every sport possible. I played golf, tennis, soccer, basketball, baseball, football, you name it, I played it. And that was my whole thing. And soccer was something that I was very good at. I played semi-pro for a couple of years. So I really loved sports. But when I was in, my senior year, I was the person that did the morning announcements. So I every morning I would get on the mic and talk to everyone that was at our school. And I tried to make it very fun. You know, I would like, and the weather today, and I would look out the window, it's snowing, or, you know, it was not any matter of fact. I didn't get any current events or anything. I just made it all up. And people really liked the humor in it all of starting their day off with me in the morning announcements. So somebody said, and I loved music. I wasn't really good. I played drums in, and I was in chorus, all-state chorus. So I loved singing, and drums, I didn't really pick up. I didn't gravitate towards it. I was more focused on sports. But I loved music, and I loved Elton John and Led Zeppelin and the Beatles, and, you know, coming up, with that as a foundation, everyone said, well, you got a great voice, you know, why don't you be a DJ? So then I started, I bought all these speakers and turntables, and I started DJing all the different high schools all around the area. And then somebody said, well, that's something you could really do. Why don't you be a DJ on a radio station? So I'm like, all right. So I went into my guidance counselor and I said, okay, what schools have radio and television, you know, programs? And, you know, we didn't grow up with a lot of money. We were in a very kind of lower middle class area of upstate New York, farming community. So my parents had saved money to put me through college, and they didn't want me to have to pay all the student loans and everything. So I said, okay, let me go to a small junior college, like a community college, to make sure this is what I want to do. So it was very minimal. It was like, you know, under $3,000 for the whole year, back then, and, with housing and everything. So it was very, very, cheap. And I really started to fall in love with radio. And then the next year was television, and I fell in love with television. And then that year that I graduated, I ended up getting a full ride scholarship because I was number one in my class. So I got a scholarship to go wherever I wanted. And there was no other place that I was going than following where my future wife was going. And she was going to Boston. So I remember going in to my guidance counselor at my community college, Herkimer Community College in upstate New York. And I said, just get me into the best film school in Boston. I am chasing my future wife. And they're like, well, that's not the greatest reason to picking a school, you know, and I don't care. I'm going there. So they're like, well, there's this place called Emerson College. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to Emerson. So we were able to use the scholarship to pay for 90% of it. And that summer that I came back after graduating from community college, my friend was going to USC. And he came back and he was doing a practicum film. So his final film project. And I asked him, could I work on it? And he said, sure. And I started, you know, getting into the lighting, getting into the grip, getting into camera, and really loving that. So when I went to Emerson, I had already signed up for mass communication. So when I came in that fall, I did a double major. I did mass comm and film at the same time. So I was taking like something radical, like 28 credit hours per semester, to be able to do both at the same time. And then eventually I just let mass communication, fall off, and I just focused all on film. So the last 2 years, I focused on film, graduated from Emerson, thinking that I was, you know, and I didn't like lighting at all. I thought director of photography, that is boring. You know, I didn't want any of that stuff. I thought I was going to be a producer. I was really good with money. I was really good with, and I could convince anybody to do anything. So I'm like, that's a producer. So I, you know, my mom bought me a three-piece suit and I got out on the street and, you know, started walking in Boston. And I'm like, hey, I'm Shane Hurlbut and I just graduated from Emerson and I like to be a producer. Doosh. You know, it's like every door was just slammed in my face. And I'm like, what is this suit? Is it the suit that mom bought? But I was like, okay, this isn't working. So then I went back to the internship that I had, which is what is that? A rental house that did lighting, grip, and camera. So I went back there, got a job at $3.50 an hour, and just started packing trucks. And within 3 months, I was running the whole grip, lighting, and camera rental division, as well as going out as a driver. So growing up on the farm, I drove 40-foot trucks, 10-ton trucks, grain trucks, all that stuff as a kid. So, you know, hopping on a tractor trailer and driving around was no big deal. So that was kind of my start in the business. Is I started out in Boston, realized that the only way I was going to move up in Boston was if the person that was above me died. Okay, because that was way it worked there. It was all seniority. So I was the little young whippersnapper with all this energy. And I was like, I'm going to be a gaffer, you know, and they're like, no, no, you're not. When you're about 50, you'll be a gaffer. And I was like, Lydia, my fiance at the time, I said, let's head out to Los Angeles where we can make it our own. And so then we moved out to Los Angeles. I started right back at the bottom again, $5 an hour. Ooh, $1.50, you know, salary bump, packing grip trucks once again in Los Angeles. And within 3 months, just like clockwork, I got offered a movie to drive a grip truck. And they told me I had to leave the rental house. And the way it went down was, the marketing guy and the producer were having a meeting up in the office, and you could view down on the second story. You could look at the parking lot. And I was, you know, because I was in big into sports, I didn't understand this whole thing that the union says, don't run. I ran everywhere. I ran to get this, ran to get that, ran back to get this, ran back. And the guy's like, who is that person that's running all over the parking lot? And they go, oh, it's this new guy, this new kid from Boston. He's got so much energy. He's just crazy with it. And he goes, and Roberto, the producer goes, can I have him as my grip truck driver? And they're like, really? And he's like, yeah. So sure enough, they talked to me. They ended up going with a different company. So they said, Shane, will you leave the rental house and become our driver? And that was this was a turning point. These are how these moments in your career where you could go, you know, this way or that way. And I said, okay, you know, Lydia was working at Children's Hospital. She had a full ride for us to move out and they paid for all of her expenses and all that stuff as a nurse at Children's. So I'm like, all right, let's see where this takes us. I could completely fall flat on my face and that's not work out. So I gave up my job and I moved on to this production. It was like a B horror film called Phantasm 2. This summer, the ball is back, right? And it was like these Martians that ran a crematorium cemetery, and they had these, you know, balls that were like a mirror ball and they had forks and it stuck into people's heads. And then a drill came out and drilled out their brains. So this was kind of how I got started. And you know, so many cool things came out of that. Like the effects team that was firing these plastic balls down the hallway. So they'd fly by camera. They came up with this spring-loaded thing on piano wire and they'd fire it and the damn thing would go like this, like 10 feet down and just wouldn't go anywhere. And I go, you know, I was a college pitcher. If you want it to go around the corner to the right, well, that's a rising fastball. If you want to go around this corner, well, that's a curveball. So I just started chucking the balls down the hallway, and that is what is in the movie, is all these balls that are going and flying by the lens are me as a, you know, 23-year-old, 24-year-old guy just chucking these plastic balls. And sometimes my rising fastball, I was never too accurate with that damn thing. So, you know, it would come off my hand wrong and just shatter up into the ceiling. And they're like, those balls are $150 a piece, you know? And I'm like, I'm sorry. But what ended up happening was one of the Best Boy Electric was a USC cinematography grad. Okay. And I get called on the radio and they say, hey, Shane, this is Terry Key Grip. He goes, hey, run an 18 by 24 flag into the crematorium set. I'm like, I'm on it. So I come in and I'm walking down the stairs, and Brian Coyne, who's the cinematography USC grad, is stops me on the stairs and he goes, Shane, look at the light. Would you be scared? And I go, what are you talking about, Brian? He goes, look, the director of photography has lit every nook and cranny. There's no shadow. And it was like, pang. From that point on, everything I looked at was light. It finally clicked in my mind. And then I went from a grip truck driver in 1988 to shooting Nirvana, Come As You Are, in 1991. So a rapid rise as a director of photography. And then, you know, I was off to the races. I started doing all the grunge era rock and roll. And then I got my first, feature, the Rat Pack, based on a music video that I shot for the film Daylight. It was with Donna Summer and Bruce Roberts. And Rob Cohen, who was the director of Daylight, sent his producing team down to check out how the music video was going. And they came back to him and they said, you got it. This thing was unbelievable. This director of photography, I've never seen anyone who commands a set like this guy. You got to check him out. And sure enough, a week later, I got a call. I went in, interviewed, and got the Rat Pack. And that's kind of was the start of my narrative career.
Right. And from there on, you've been involved in many feature film productions. You've been running your academy for filmmaking, which we're going to talk about later on as well, shooting commercials and all kind of things like that. I'm curious to hear, though, what was the inner shift, the mind shift? You said you're coming from this farming community. How did you start dreaming and having these ambitions about making it as a filmmaker? Like, for many people from the small, you know, places like villages and towns, it's hard for them to see the role model. How did you shift and started to dream and to believe and that you can actually achieve a lot and succeed?
I think a lot of that is your upbringing. You know, it's like my parents were so good with letting me just kind of decide what I wanted to do. They didn't force me down any roads. I mean, my dad was a professor's assistant at Cornell. I had a full ride at Cornell. Absolutely free, 4 years if I wanted to take it. And I didn't. And there was no pressure or animosity from my parents. They just wanted me to be great at whatever I chose. And they really, that base and foundation was very early on. Both of them were teachers in their own right. You know, my mom was a sixth grade teacher. My dad was a professor's assistant. So he would take all the grad students on the farm where they're doing all their experiments. And he, you know, really took them through the process of what it means to, you know, plant and harvest and till and all this stuff. He was in agronomy. So the science of plants and making hybrids for sweet corn and soybeans and all this stuff. So, you know, that I think that was really the ability that I could dream, and whatever I loved and was my passion, they were all on board for it. They didn't. I hear so many parents saying, okay, you can go to school, but you can't go far away from home. You can go to school, but I want you to be a lawyer. You can go to school, but I want you to be a doctor. That was not my upbringing. You can go to school and be whatever you want. was my upbringing. So I just tried everything. And, you know, I started out as a grip truck driver, and then I became a dolly grip, and I learned how to move the camera, and I made all the mistakes, and, you know, didn't remember when to boom up correctly, or forgot to charge the dolly. And the director of photography, the operator's looking at me, "What are you, dumb?" You know, it's like, come on, dude, you got to be on it, you know. And I'm trying to figure out my way. And then I became a key grip, because a lot of the upbringing on the farm is a lot about rigging and, you know, doing a lot of stuff that is very common sense based in regards to, you know, planning stuff out. And then I learned to be a best boy electric, and learned how to distribute power and how to balance it and all that. And then a gaffer, and then a director of photography. So I really went up the technical side, and then I did a little camera assisting as well, because I wanted to learn more about that. So I learned how to load cameras. I learned how to, you know, what it took to pull focus, understand measurement, just be organized in general, as a lot of the etiquette of what a camera assistant does. So, you know, I just tried everything. And then all of a sudden, that moment on Phantasm 2 was when it all clicked, and I just saw this was going to be my future. And I just, you know, I think about how quickly it happened, but you got to understand it wasn't kind of quick, because 1 year I did 102 music videos in 1 year. So imagine that. It's like most people work, you know, 200 days out of the year, 180 days out of the year, let's say, but I was working like almost 320 days out of the year. And so, and all different varying projects. So I got a huge breadth of working for different director of photographies, and them being my mentors and kind of shaping who I was, as an artist.
I think this is an amazing lesson for everybody. Having clarity what you're after and really going after it. And what I want to dig into, since this is productivity mastery, and I think you have a lot of lessons to share, is you mentioned the word planning, and you also said that you had a good capacity to be a successful producer. What do you do? How do you set priorities? How do you make sure that you plan things effectively? Could you share some lessons, and maybe just to give a little bit more of a nuance, on a big feature film production, how do you, with all these responsibilities, all the tasks that you have as a director of photography, how do you set priorities and make sure that you stay on focus?
Yeah, I mean, I think over the years, I have come up with and it's taken it takes a long time to master making movies. You know, everyone thinks, okay, well, you just show up and you're going to shoot the scene and everything. There's so much that goes into it with production design and, you know, the way the camera feels, the way the lighting feels, hair, makeup, wardrobe, VFX, special effects. There's so many people that have a creative expression in the movie. And so your job, your most difficult job as a director and as a director of photography, is communicating the vision, because you have so many creatives and you got to get everyone making one movie instead of everyone making their own movies. And that's what I have, you know, finally mastered, is being able to come up with communication styles and documents that do not put people in silos, but bring people together and work on one united document that then educates every single department. And that used to be the script. And the script, to some extent, does that. But there's so many ways that you can interpret a script, and you can interpret the emotion. So the emotion needs to be interpreted from the director. And that has to all, so what's the director interprets that emotion to myself and the production designer, then now it's my job to start taking every department and kind of communicate that division, communicating the vision. And I've seen it done so many ways. There's storyboards, obviously, that are very descriptive, and they show you exactly what the frame is going to be. You can see how many shots are in a scene. You can break down a movie very efficiently with that. But storyboards can also be a very much of a moving target. You know, the storyboards are conceptualized by the director and myself, and then, you know, they're not really, you know, because you're doing it, quote unquote, in a vacuum. So, you know, it's not designed per the location. So a lot of the physicalities, the location, are not going to enable us to get the angles and the shots that are in the storyboard. So that's why I take the approach of storyboards are the last thing that I'm involved in. I want to be able to come up with the shot list and the blocking. And then that educates what the story storyboards are. And you really can't shot list and block until you have locations, until you know what those schematics are of a set. So, you know, you can't put the cart before the horse, let's say. So very much is, you know, getting in. My first day of prep is just being in a van for, you know, 10 hours going from location to location of all the stuff that the director and the production designer has worked on prior to me getting there. Or what's been happening on during COVID is we all start together, which I think is the best way to do a movie anyway. And so many studios have veered off this path where, you know, they start the director of photography only like 8 weeks or 6 weeks before production. And all I do for those 6 weeks is play catch up. So the last three films that I did in COVID, we did together. So the production designer, the producer, myself, the director, we all start together. So we're all looking at locations together and we're planning it all out and we're hearing, you know, my thoughts on it before the producer and the production designer and the director already say, oh, I love this location. And I'm like, yeah, it is a great location, but we're on the 20th floor and it's going to be really difficult to keep this light consistent up here. Can we see how we can, you know, maybe make a compromise or, you know, or the lighting change or, you know, so it's like these type of things usually are baked in and I have no way of changing it. And you only hope that the producer and the production designer and the director really knock it out for you. So they line up you to have success. Fathers and Daughters was a perfect example. I got brought in only 4 weeks before production started. The production designer and the director had already locked in all the locations, and luckily every single one of them was amazing and worked for me lighting wise and all that stuff. But that is very few and far between. And it all depends on the director's vision. You know, Gabriel Muccino does something very unique. He embeds the shot list into the script. So the script being usually 108 or 110 pages becomes 240. And because every shot is embedded into the script, so it's a working document. So I said, okay, Gabriele, let's take this even further. If we're going to use the script and you're putting the shot list in, why don't I describe what the light is going to be in the room and the mood and the tone and the way the camera is going to feel and the color tone in the room. So then what I did is based on that document, then I would put the look in there. So now the script end up going up to 300 some odd pages because I would describe the light in every scene. So now the script becomes the most incredible communicative tool because now I'm describing what the light is going to look like, what the color tone, what the mood is, what the camera is going to feel like. And then they have Gabrielli's shot list. So now you can, as a director of photography, or sorry, as a production designer, you can say, okay, well, it doesn't look like he's looking this direction. So I don't have to dress that. Yeah, exactly. You don't. This is what we're doing. We're only doing this. So it's once you start to get this communication in where the script really becomes the, and then with that script, I do blocking schematics and shot listing where you see the cameras move around and dance with the actors, you know, and then you can design the lighting off of that blocking. And so it's really these documents that I've kind of created and then making the script be as much of the main communicative, you know, that drives the communication to every department. That is, that's kind of been my new mastering the prep, is really trying to come up with documents that, like, is a perfect example. When I did Love Hard up in Vancouver, this look document was sent out to all the departments, and the hair and makeup, or no, the wardrobe costume designer said, I've never gotten this from a director of photography. I know if you're going orange, I can go a color on a color tone. I know I can dress my actors in different colors based on what I know what the room is going to look like and the mood and the color tone. So it starts to, and then hair and makeup is able to pick up on that. And then, you know, VFX and production design, because they can see the blocking and they can see that, oh, we aren't looking that way. We don't have to dress that, or we don't have to build that part of the set. And these are the things that have really started to hone in, and with these 10-hour days and with COVID-19 restrictions and everything that we have to do to still try to make a movie in this pandemic environment, I found that without this amount of prep and design, you cannot pull off the ultimate vision. And that's where, you know, during COVID, I reinvented how I prep. And I tried it out on Love Hard for the first time coming out of the pandemic, and it just blew people's minds. So I knew I was on to something. And then on junior year, I completely continued to finesse it to the point of just like everyone saying these aha moments of, oh my God, I've never walked on set so confident, so knowing exactly what we were going to do. My team had a roadmap. You think about it, I use this example. Okay, so say you have a gaffer and a key grip, and then they have all their departments, and they have their pre-rigged, the rigging teams as well. So they come in and rig locations ahead of time. So when we get in there, at least a lot of the stuff is either hung or cables run or whatever. So imagine you telling a rigging gaffer and rigging key grip to go from Los Angeles, drive from Los Angeles to New York, and you give them no map. All you give them is a compass. Okay? So how efficiently are they going to be able to get from Los Angeles to New York without a map? But if I give them a map, they're going to get there very efficiently. So what I started to do is, you know, on most of my movies, the big scenes and big sets, I would do lighting schematics for. And I would always have issues with budget. I have not, you know, they're asking for a lot more man days for rigging. They're asking for larger crews. They're asking for more this, more that. We don't have it, Shane. It's not in our budget. And I said, okay. This is not the greatest situation. I don't like having these conversations. So I'm like, what if I do a lighting schematic and a blocking schematic and a shot list for every scene in the movie? And how will that work? So this on this last movie, 142 lighting schematics, 272 blocking schematics, and a shot list based on 70 plus scenes in the movie was all built within the first 4 weeks of my prep. And once my team started, there was no conversation about man days. There was no budget problems other than, hey, I got to limit a little bit here and, oh, we got to do, but all seamless, absolutely effortless is how that rolled out. And with that, I was able to walk in every day. I had the team knew exactly. I mean, I got so granular with it, with gags. okay, a light's going to be turning on in the room, so we need to make sure we have this, that, and the other thing. Oh, we're going to be using negative fill here, so make sure you're building a 12 by 20 and a 12. I mean, so granular that the team could literally build all this. And when I would walk in, we were almost lit. I would finesse it and we would go. And we would stay on the 10-hour days. And we would continue to have a very successful and healthy production. People didn't get COVID. We were able to go home after 10 hours and get the needed rest that we that was required. We were able to have, you know, time off on the weekends. So we weren't, you know, moving the schedule where, like with most productions, if you started at 6 a.m. on a Monday, you were usually into 4 p.m. calls by Friday. Well, that never happened on a 10-hour day. You never had to push your calls. So everyone stayed in a very relaxed environment. And I felt it was the best movie experience that I've ever had. And it doesn't mean that Greatest Game wasn't an incredible experience. It was. But this is where I felt like I finally mastered the craft of prepping and being a director of photography.